reports, okay, of our compliance to follow the requirement by certification.
And look at higher transaction costs.
Okay? Which is also complicated for the thing.
Then I did account ethics studies. And with my students, I put it in the paper. So basically, Indonesian coffee has low level of transmission elasticity, meaning the changing in consumer price very slowly transmitted into the farmers. But sometimes the direction is the other way around. If the price and global price is increasing, it's very slowly transmitted to the farmers. However, if the global price is decreasing, it's fastly transmitted to the farmers. Which is that last year, 2016, the farmers suffering at Kusei because the lowering global price. But since December, I think global price is reviving. Second study is, I did again measuring PSM. This is a PSM studies by looking evaluation, applying. Well, actually, I was asking the machine to see the impact of adoption of agroforestry and of this application. We have only two samples: Rainforest Alliance and 4C. And the results, agroforestry system has positive impact on environmental benefit. I mentioned earlier because people, farmers do not apply chemical fertilizer, but have no significant impact on economic benefit. Farm income of agroforestry adopters and non-adopter has no statistical differences. We have 400 samples of it, so it's enough sample to generate propensity score matching PSM. But here, interesting, coffee certificates have a positive, significant impact on improving economic benefit, which is nice. Higher farm income and both an environmental benefit by less chemical fertilizer. Farmers joining RFA has higher economic and environmental benefits compared to 4C. So in terms of environmental and resources economy, this implication is very good. Good implication meaning because RFA, I could say, has stringent requirement of environment compared to 4C. So it's still positive in terms of farmers income. Of course, we have to do a lot of studies on that. Last one is by our student, he's now doing PhD in Maastricht University. This is one of his studies. We compare what are the factors, preferences, adopting the attributes of certification. Okay, this is nice. This is the result. Small models in different groups, because we differentiate global, local certification and non-certification. There's local certification, of course, in office certification. Preferences are comparable across the group, except for environmental focus. All farmers prefer conservation, but farmers with local certification prefer organic. So the varieties of result in each coffee producing center, I think, have an important implication. Farmers learning global certification have a fairness of a plant, okay, with non-certificated coffee. Farmers learning local and non-certificated group show the opposite preferences. I put in the table like this. There are attributes, we have 8 attributes after doing the work. The decision to adopt certification is mostly price driven. Not the there are two of environmental focus because some farmers are farming in the protection forest. Okay. Third one is price difference with non-certified coffee.
And all the this thing that we thought it was very important, in fact, it's not about credit cards and master scheme and so on. It's just interesting to start with. However, we put a note here. The study should not be treated as steady and unchangeable because sometimes farmers think as in the short term. Okay, we still have homework to encourage farmers to really adopt the sustainability practice. If we put it this way, farmers display opportunist behavior and may abandon one certification. One certain scheme to participate in when the second one of other funds in higher financial incentive. Which is it's not steady, I would say. It's not steady. There are a lot of studies have to be done. But in general, I mentioned earlier, it's really it's not have a direct high benefits of a certification. There's an ambiguity in the result. Okay? I put some suggestions. I quote the studies by Peter Grasberger. What is the scenarios for the future about the growing certification? Leave it to the market or bring the state back in to participate, to inform the state. And Indonesian government actually tried to adopt, but only after President SBY, this current president will not continue. We call it, we develop East Coffee, because we are doing East Pole for palm oil, Indonesia sustainable palm oil, in addition to Toronto sustainable palm oil. In coffee, they are developing East Coffee, and also they are developing East Cocoa, okay? Maybe for East is another one. Or East President Metabo. So ladies and gentlemen, a lot of things we have to learn from this study. Thank you very much. In fact, this session is on.
Thank you. You know, can I invite questions or comments to Ms. Kanu? Max?
Thank you, Pak, for your presentation. I would like you to elaborate more why increasing price of coffee in the world price is not well transmitted to the farmers. Why is that? And then the second thing is about the regions that you saw that have a good production of coffee, but a lot of poor farmers there. And how can you explain why it's happened? It's because maybe they are not really a big. Your data sort of kind of big farmer, or there's any other reason? Sometimes maybe the supply chain is too, or maybe they net consumer for other product that increase much higher than the coffee. Sometimes they consume net consumer of chili or onions that have high contribute to the inflation rather than the coffee itself. Thank you.
Thank you. The second question is the hardest. That's why I put money on the background. I didn't do that analysis on the second. But it's really disturbing us. Those with producing regions of coffee, they are poor. Okay. It's why I put only in the background. So I try to go deep into that. What happened in the coffee? Okay. And I come with some descriptive finding that. Those coffee less than, I could say small order, 95% of them are really small, so they cannot make good contribution even for the living. Okay? Probably the big question for us, how much the economies of scale of coffee practice in Indonesia? And we don't know. The optimal, we don't know. Probably, I guess, probably. If you have 2 hectares or up, and you will be okay. And those PTPN, state-owned enterprises, plantation companies, of course, they are large-scale farming practices, and of course, they are adopting many technologies, including domesticating the luwak. Okay. They're trying to domesticate the luwak this time. It's not free luwak. So this kind of thing, so if we cannot solve this very structural problem, I think we will find the similar results that globalization or coffee eco-certification cannot contribute very much to the farmers' income, at least at the coffee. Your first question about the large countries, why is it increasing? It's not only because of law, but the characters are different. Coffee markets, final products coffee market, totally different compared from the bean market and the green coffee market. So there are, I could say, three, maybe four different market segments. Even though we're talking about coffee, but the characteristic, the players and the traders are also different. So, I mentioned earlier, if the global price increase, it's slowly transmitted to the farm level. But on the other hand, because the power, that is why I put my middleman over there, the power of middleman is still there. Middleman is still the middleman. They're not only simply middleman, but farmers depend on them. But this time, after the certification, there are a lot of, I didn't put in my paper, there's a lot of tendency. Normally because big companies, I could mention Nestle, Starbucks, and so on, of course, they are themselves cannot operate at the local level, but they are partner with our local major. That's one so-called OPAP. Yes, there are differences in terms of better price a little bit compared to 20 years ago or so on. But price premium that the farmers fighting for is not that easy. Maybe we have to work on that in the farm level. I'm just going to pass it.
Other question?
Hi, I'm a student from NUS,
Global
Studies. I wanted to thank you for your presentation because I felt like it was like a direct application to what I've been taught so far. And I actually wanted to add a fourth possible scenario, if possible. You mentioned that one of the weaknesses of institutionalizing meta-governance is that the power of meta-governance is often doubted. Am I right? Yeah. I was wondering, what do you think of the possibility of technopreneurships? Like, for example, we have Uber, right? Which connects drivers with passengers. What do you think is the potential of having like an Uber, but for coffee producers or agricultural producers in general? Because what I see here is the issue of the market, elasticity, the elasticity, price elasticity of the commodities are not functioning as how you want, how you want them to. Yeah.
Thank you. I agree, totally agree. Unfortunately, I did not consider the domestic market. Domestic market is really, really powerful. Entrepreneurship should support that. Young guys now start doing up. After ada apa dengan cinta tu, okay? They are only talking about barista coffee. It's really growing. Domestic market lifestyle newly growing. My son this time doing homework in cafe, so in the library. So this kind of thing soon, I think maybe domestic demand will be increasing. I agree that entrepreneurship is one way, maybe to really link directly or improve the farmers' health. But I didn't pull on that, sorry.
Okay. Last question? Yes. Can you speak up, please?
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you, Prabhu Swami. I just want to clarify about on your second paragraph. That, for example, the correlation between poor and the inclusion of poor people in the presentation, linked with the higher public protection in the region. In this case, we compare between people and the company. Company or established company who has a transmission. Because regarding to the agricultural sector, that Sumatra Island and Kalimantan, that mostly the farmer not contribute too much. That mostly produced by a Japanese company. In this case, in my opinion, maybe should be looking that into labor perspective assessment, because the individual is not comparable with the company. And the second one on your conclusion. I just want to clarify on one thing to know that the preference of consumers was segregated for local, provincial, and international related with eco copy or just traditional copy. I think that's very important because it was mentioned there is no significance. Thank you very much.
Regular value chain.
But this time I believe they will talk again about that by grading the quality and whether the sourcing, whether the coffee comes from national park or not, this traceability criteria. I think they will differentiate, and those who can capture this opportunity, I think will be off from the photo. This is the thesis of
it. Thank you. Please take Juan Gustavo. Up next is Rick Barkello talking about reducing rural poverty through trade. Evidence from Indonesia.
What I'm going to talk about today is focusing on the question of poverty. So we're not going to be looking at income inequality, but trying to find out what is the evidence from, again, from Indonesia on looking at rural poverty and the effects of it. Can it be reduced or increased by trade? And this is work with me. My co-author is an Indonesian graduate student working with me. So we're not going to have poverty generally, but focus on poverty in rural areas. Of course, as you know, that's where the lowest incomes in the country usually are. And people in rural areas that are the poorest have only their own labor to sell. So they don't have assets. And so if you really want to improve their situation and raise their income, it has to be really through wage rates rising. So we're going to focus on that. We're going to be looking at these rural labor markets and to try and see if we can reduce poverty by raising the wage rates in rural areas. What we do, we don't have data on broadly rural wage rates, but we do have data on agricultural wage rates. So we'll focus on that. Now there's many tools that you could use to try and raise rural wages, agricultural wages. We're focusing on two here that we think are important. One being trade protection. For agricultural products, we're going to, because of its importance, we're going to focus on rice and look at protection, border protection for rice through tariff, or you could say also through import restrictions implemented by Bulog. And we're going to compare that with a labor market option, which we suspect is important as well. That is to say, open migration from rural to urban areas. Now, what makes it quite interesting to use Indonesian data here is that there's such high levels of migration within Indonesia, so it gives us a kind of a unique opportunity to test that. Now, both of these tools, if you want to think of them as two different tools, they're both widely important in Indonesia. So as I said, rice, like most food crops, is protected with trade restrictions and is on an import basis. If you know when rice policy is discussed and when there are proposals to raise rice tariffs or increase import restrictions, it's always undertaken with the rhetoric of this is important for reducing rural poverty. So in other words, if you look at that rhetoric that you hear, it would suggest that if you raise trade barriers, you will help raise rural wages and reduce poverty. And so that would, in the context of this larger project, that would suggest that trade normally would have a negative effect on poverty. If you open up to trade, that prices of especially on import commodities. that's essentially what we're trying to examine. Migration, though, in Indonesia, especially from rural to urban, is substantial, and we know that that has, that's a form of human capital, just like health and education, and a source, a potential source of increased income. So we're going to try and look at the relative merits of these two tools for reducing poverty. If we're going to do this, though, then what we need is a little model of how these rural labor markets are actually working, and in particular, what is determining rural wage, agricultural wage rates. So one scenario to think about is, in constructing this model, is are these agricultural labor markets independent of urban labor markets? So, I mean, this is what some people have thought, and that careers have been made on that, just that hypothesis. A Nobel Prize winner, Arthur Lewis, was one such example. And he argued, this was a long time ago, back in the 1950s, but he argued that the agricultural wage does not respond to the urban or the industrial sector wages, that it only responded to agricultural variables. And so that one scenario is to ask that question, which we do. Whether these two different poverty reduction routes, they suggest a quite different government policies. So if rice prices are really important, that the agricultural wage really does not depend on what's going on in Jakarta and or other cities, then using rice prices would be a policy to reduce poverty. Or if on the other hand, the urban sector is really important in affecting agricultural wage rates, then having a policy of growth in the non-farm sector, including off-farm employment, may be best way to lower poverty. So that's another perspective of what we're trying to do here. So I'm just elaborating on this here, that right price policy is one way to try to raise wages and reduce poverty, especially if that's an important factor, whereas on the other side, you want to encourage more migration, or at least not discourage it, and make sure that the non-farm economy is strong, and that, and perhaps with good rural infrastructure, that will be the most potent tool for raising wages and reducing poverty. So, the reason I came to this particular research is, in my early years of looking at agricultural labor markets in Indonesia, my observations were in stark contrast to the predictions and the assumptions in this model developed by Arthur Lewis. And so, what Lewis did not really consider was the very high level of rural to urban migration that one commonly sees here in Indonesia. But in addition, even in the 1980s and the mid-80s, already the population involved in rice farming was diminishing. And perhaps Lewis has his version of reality founded upon an environment where a large percentage of the population was in agriculture. So what I was observing was, if I put it in the opposite form, in an extreme form, it was seeming to me that the urban wage rates were not just attracting people from agriculture to work outside the agriculture sector, but they might even be setting the agricultural wage. In other words, that the agricultural sector could be seen as a price taker. You know, this might not surprise you in a rich country that would be true when you have 2 or 4 or maybe 8% of the population is in agriculture, but it seems like it was a bit early for that kind of picture to be developing in Indonesia. So what we are trying to do is build a little model of this agriculture two sets of variables are going to affect the wage rate. So we're going to have some factors that are derived from the farm, such as the rice price. We're going to have some variables that are derived from the non-farm economy, such as the urban manufactured wage, and to see how do their relative effects differ. And of course, that will tell us quite a lot about what is the best policy. One question that you might ask, again, thinking about how you would generalize these results to other countries, is are labor markets within Indonesia unique? Are they different from what you might find in other countries within Asia, or even more broadly with other developing countries around the world? So I just cite a few things here that I think are quite important, and they are somewhat unique. There has been no recent history of migration restrictions in Indonesia, so you can contrast that with China or Vietnam, where there have been substantial restrictions on migration. In fact, migration to work out of agriculture in the urban sector in those countries was illegal until not terribly long ago. Another characteristic is that rural labor has moderate skill levels in Indonesia, enough education to at least compete for unskilled jobs in the urban market. That there's also, and that's not true in all countries. If you go to a number of African countries, you find that rural labor has a very low skill levels and are at an enormous disadvantage in competing in the urban labor market. Also in Indonesia, very high observed migration flows, as we talked, except of course for recessions, such as the Asian financial crisis, and for individuals, of course, some people succeed and some people don't. The agricultural share of GDP has fallen to about 15%, that's important. Heavy involvement of farm family labor in off-farm employment is something that's been widely observed in the country. And many observations of farm workers from villages, village levels, farm workers moving to non-agricultural jobs in villages, village workers migrating to regional towns, and then labor in regional towns moving onward to large cities. So of course this is all aided by the kind of population density that you find here. Because what that means is that it lowers the cost of migration and raises the benefits. So it's probably somewhat unique, at least in terms of the degree to which you find this among other lower middle countries. So I put together this model, because we're looking at data from 1983 to 2009, we have to be very careful with how we go about estimating these relationships. So we follow quite formal time series fund metrics. And because of that, we have to keep our model quite simple. So we did that. We focused on only three parts of Indonesia, three provinces. So at that time, these were just three provinces in Java, West Central and East. And we could get these data for that whole time period from them. It would have been nice to get more data on the outer islands, because you might think that they would have, there might be less integration between the urban and the rural labor markets. On the other hand, the wage differences are probably larger and there may be a higher percentage of migrate. We would have liked to have done that, but unfortunately, our data is just from Java. This gives you a summary of it. I know it's a bit hard to read all this. We have wage rates at the province level, agricultural wage rates. Actually, we have wage rates for three different agricultural activities, which we put together to make this rural wage variable. We deflated it and put it into real terms. We have the manufacturing wage rate as a proxy for what what agricultural laborers would be able to get if they moved, if they migrated. Also, we played with that. We had a rice price variable, and we had that at the province level. And finally, we looked at GDP growth, quarterly manufactured GDP growth, as a proxy for any aspects of the demand for labor in the urban areas. It was not captured by the manufacturing wage. You probably know that when most people migrate from rural areas, they don't get into a manufacturing sector job. They often go to the service sector. And we would like to have data on service sector wages, but unfortunately we couldn't get that. So we used GDP growth in the manufacturing sector as a proxy for that. Okay, let me just quickly go through some information on the actual wage rate and the data that we have. And I want you just to see the patterns in those, in the wage rate data, to try and ask ourselves, are we dealing with data here that makes sense? So here's the time series of the urban wage rate. And there's several things you can see here. Do you notice how the wage rate fell quite sharply here? That's the Asian financial crisis. That's 1998-99 here. And then you can see what's happened after that. The wage rate grew quite steadily, quite aggressively, and then it kind of stabilized for the latter part of our period up to 2009. If we look at the agricultural wage rate, you can see it followed, it wasn't growing as quickly at the earlier period. Then the Asian financial crisis is also very evident, just like in the manufacturing sector. And then there was no growth for a while in the agricultural wage, and then it jumped very sharply, and then dropped a bit right there at the end of the period. So we looked at this a little bit more closely. And here's the ratio of two. You'll see now that if you look at the starting point and the ending point, you'll see that they're gradually converging. That is to say, the difference between the urban and the rural wage is gradually diminishing. You'll see no evidence of the Asian financial crisis in the ratio because it affected both of them equally. And then you'll see, then you'll see over this period here, this is where that period where the urban wage started to go up after the Asian financial crisis, but there was quite a long lag before the agricultural wage caught up. And then, of course, it does and pushes this ratio downward. So the data seemed to conform to a lot of things that we saw, and it helped. I won't go into all the details now, but it helped our confidence in the data that we had. That just puts all three together. Still some puzzles in the data. There's this question of why was the agricultural wage so flat for 4 years after the Asian financial crisis when the manufacturing sector wage rates were rising? It could have been that there was actually quite, even though the wage rates went up, there was quite slow growth in manufacturing jobs, and slow growth in the informal sector wages, and it could have been that that's what caused the agricultural wage to stay a bit flat. That is to say, there weren't many of these jobs becoming available, and it could alternatively have been on the supply side, that maybe workers in the agricultural sector were a little reluctant to move back into the construction and other jobs they were finding in the cities after the financial crisis, maybe just wanting to wait to see if those jobs were really available and the wage rate really had risen. We don't know the answer. Those are some possible explanations. And then I just look a little bit at some of the other literature and
these kinds of stories like fit that I don't want to delay us. So let me just move on. We have to follow this kind of time series econometrics methodology of testing for human groups and doing co-integration tests. I won't go into that anymore. Let's just jump to the results. So these are the results separated into each of the three provinces. And you can, and these numbers here are elasticities. So you can see that in West Java, for example, the rice price, if the rice price went up by 1%, the agricultural wage would go up by 0.14%. And you can see that if the manufacturing wage rate went up by 1%, and the agricultural wage would go up by 0.26. The urban GDP growth rate would raise those wage rates by 0.14. You can see you have similar results, but a little different in which one is actually the larger or largest in any particular situation. And so when we put those together, we see that the manufacturing wage rate is the most significant in all of these different variables. For a 1% rise in manufacturing wage rate, a 0.3% increase in the farm wage rate. And in contrast, the price would only raise agricultural wage rates by 0.1%. So you can see that's a three times, manufacturing wage rate has three times the size in those coefficients. And then if you want to look at the urban growth rate, that's picking up the service sector a bit more, whereas this one here is the manufacturing sector, then you add another 0.2 to the effect of this variable on the agricultural wage rate. So another way to look at this, to take these data then, is to look at what has happened since the year 2000. And so we take these are elasticities that I'm referring to are long-run.
These are long-run elasticities, and so when the rice, you may recall that the rice tariff went up by 25% in 2000. So what that would have done, again, taking our coefficient, it is to raise farm wage rate by 2.6%. And that would be a once-for-all effect because the tariff increased 25% just once. So that's the effect. But what about urban GDP growing at 5 to 7% per year? So that our coefficients would have raised farm wage rate by 1 to 1.5% per year, or 10 to 15% over the decade. And then looking at the manufacturing wage rate side, the same thing. That would have had a slightly larger effect, 15 to 20% for that decade. So the rice tariff increase, which occurred once, that would have boosted farm rate wage rate by only 1/7 to 1/8 as much as the manufacturing wage rate did. And if you add in the non-farm GDP, that would mean that the non-farm sector effects are about 10 times the effect of that that one-time increase in the wage rate. So what our study has allowed us to see is that we can get a bit of a clearer picture of how these linkages seem to operate between the rural and the urban labor market, that wage rate patterns are quite predictable, especially the manufacturing wage rate, that the agricultural wage rates in the long run are mostly caused by non-farm factors, only modestly affected by farm prices. And so the long-run impact of government trade policy by raising the tariff and raising the rice price has a very limited effect on rural wages and the poorest farmers in Java. So if you want to look at the policy implications, that's one way to try to learn lessons from this, that migration is a much more powerful tool for raising agricultural wage rates than agricultural trade protection. And of course, how you accomplish it is not only by keeping off or removing restrictions on migration, but you want to have the non-farm economy as essentially the driver of this, and a strong non-farm economy is probably one of the best ways to raise both agricultural and rural wage rates. But of course, as I mentioned earlier, you want to make sure that people in the agricultural and rural areas have the necessary education levels to compete in the non-agricultural labor market. We know from other research that increased trade protection has another effect that we haven't really documented here, a regressive effect, and that is by raising the rice price, it will help raise land prices for farmers who own land. And of course, raises the cost for all consumers, especially poor ones. So we know that there's this other side to raising the rice tariff. We don't measure inequality, but we can look,
good question, Dudi. First of all, let me say that
I wouldn't put quite as much emphasis as your question suggests on the manufacturing sector per se. I would say it applies a little bit more broadly to both manufacturing and service sector wage rates. And numbers that we had were that the if you can make a distinction between the coefficients on those two variables, the wage rate and the growth rate of GDP, slightly larger effect to the manufacturing wage rate. But I'm not sure if our data is allows us to make that distinction quite so strongly. But it does raise the question that, of raising the minimum wage, is that going to be having a significant effect on the manufacturing wage rate? That then gets into questions of the coverage of the minimum wage and whether manufacturing wages are already higher than that minimum. If that's the case, it probably won't have too much effect. On the other hand, there will probably be some reduction in the number of jobs. We don't know how much, but from raising the minimum wage. It would mean that there wouldn't be those opportunities so much for rural migrants, and they would be even more likely to end up in the service sector. So I would there's just enough ifs in the causation that I'm not sure I would say that there's much of a strong effect from the raising the minimum wage on rural wage, on farm wage rates.
Next question, Umi.
Thank you for the maybe it's the thing for which you are proper, but I think it's the I just want to know what you are meaning about. It is a common fact in the world that there is a sort of farmer. There's a sort of farmer in Japan, in Indonesia, so that's why maybe there is not only the urbanization phenomenon, but also international migration. Because currently, Indonesia sent a lot of farmers to go abroad under very or cheap labor or something like that. In the name of so for example, in Japan for example, the farmer can get and earn money more than $1 million per month if they as a training farmer and they have a long term contract for 3 years. So I just want to know what your opinion is.
Right. So we didn't really have any measurement of this effect at all in our work. We didn't have any measures of those rates. And think of this as just looking at domestic migration. And so if there's these additional opportunities for farmers to participate in this international scheme, that would be a job category that would build the effects of increased income or improve wage rates to farmers, improve income to farmers above anything we have here. So it's really something that we didn't capture separately. But it does, it wouldn't depend so much on the wage rate within Indonesia. I mean the rice price in Indonesia, right? So it would, I think, to the extent that's important, it would be even less the value to Indonesia of raising that rice tariff is going to have an even smaller effect on agricultural wage rates.
Anyone else?
Sorry, when you say migration, it's rural, urban, farm to not farm. It's the opposite of transportation, right?
That's right. Remember, we're not measuring migration.
Right.
We because we don't have any data on it. So we're just looking at the wage rates as in the two sectors as a proxy for what's actually going on. So you might say, well, why should it be that the manufacturing wage rate has any effect on the wage rate for hard skilled labor except for Java, right? So it's only the two get connected only by way of the migration. Right. So when we see these quite large coefficients on these manufacturing wage rates and the non-farm GDP growth, that tells us that's linking those two labor markets and causing a large impact on the agricultural wage rate. So but we don't have an actual variable, which would be kind of nice, to measure the direct effect of the migration. We can just see the results of the migration that produced these results.
Please join me in thanking Rudy. The next presentation is from FMP, that's Buddha Zanto and